But this guy, John Lewis, let's talk about him, okay, as we're moving right along. John Lewis, wow. Congressman John Robert Lewis, a Georgia statesman who was reelected to the U.S. House of Representatives every 2 years for the last 33 years. 17 times he was reelected to his seat in the United States House of Representatives. 2 weeks ago, on Friday, July 17th, he died of pancreatic cancer at the age of 80, okay? John Lewis was a close associate of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and Dr. King affectionately called John Lewis the boy from Troy. He's from Troy, Alabama, okay? John Lewis was actually the last surviving person to have spoken at the 1963 March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom, the time where Dr. King gave his I Have a Dream speech. John Lewis was 23 years old at the time and also was the chairman of the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee, SNCC. He was the chair of SNCC. 23 years old, he spoke at the same rally on the National Mall in front of a quarter of a million people, 250,000 people. At 23 years old, he spoke there. For the young folks out here, let me flip that script. For the older folks out here, y'all better recognize youth are a powerful influence out here. And I've been saying this for the longest. I've been saying it for the longest. If Dr. King would have overlooked John Lewis because of his age, John Lewis might not have ever spent that 33 years in the U.S. House of Representatives or even gotten that send-off as he did yesterday with three presidents, George W. Bush, Bill Clinton, and my president, Barack Obama, all speaking at his funeral. If Dr. King would have looked and said, that boy from Troy, man, leave him because he's a kid. He's a kid. Leave him alone. Mm-mm. Eli, I appreciate you. I appreciate you for sure. And I stand with the youth for sure. So 2 years after the Dream Speech and the March on Washington, in 1965, at the ripe old age of 25, he's 25 years old now, John Lewis led the first of three Selma to Montgomery marches across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in an incident that became known as Bloody Sunday. Under his leadership and that of civil rights leader Hosea Williams, more than 600 peaceful demonstrators marched across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Alabama protesting for what? The right to vote. The right to vote. The right to change things. The right to stop those who do not have the best interests of the people from continuing to have that and to put people in office that will have the best interests of the people. At that time, black folks were definitely being denied the right to vote. Throughout the South, voter suppression of the black vote was universal and it was absolute. When black folk tried to vote, they were often told by white election officials that they had gotten the date wrong, or they got the time on the application wrong, or they got the polling location wrong as a reason to deny them access to the vote, or that they had filled out the application incorrect. They had a laundry list of excuses why a black person couldn't vote. White folks just walk up and vote. Black folks, laundry list of reasons why they couldn't vote. Often, black voters were forced to take literacy tests or even to guess the number of jelly beans in a jar or forced to recite the entire Constitution, a task that most white voters probably couldn't do then. Voter suppression. John Lewis and Hosea Williams and 600 more people decided to that by any means necessary, through peaceful, through nonviolent protest, they were going to make their voice be heard. in order to get the right to vote. On March 7th, 1965, with John Lewis and Hosea Williams leading the way from Selma, Alabama, across the Edmund Pettus Bridge, as the marchers reached the other side, they were greeted by Alabama state troopers and the police who were waiting on them, who immediately ordered them to disperse. And when they heard the order, John Lewis and Hosea Williams and the 600 other protesters, they all stopped and they took a knee. Yeah, see, this is a patriotic thing, taking a knee. And they took a knee and they started to pray. But folks, how many of you know evil is what evil does? As they were praying, they were attacked by Alabama state troopers and the police. The police fired tear gas into their midst while they were on their knee praying. And mounted troopers charged the demonstrators on their horses, beating them with nightsticks and bats. And I got a note that says handmade devices. A lot of times these were things like they take a big piece of wood, right, and wrap it up with barbed wire or something like that in order to make a makeshift weapon. 600 unarmed, peaceful, nonviolent protesters who took a knee to pray. This is what they were greeted with, because all they wanted to do was cast a vote for somebody that they figured would represent them. John Lewis's skull was fractured in that confrontation, a scar that carried him for the rest of his life. And as he would later recount, he said he thought he was going to die that day. But guess what? He didn't. He didn't die. He survived. And this direct action that they did that day, led by the 25-year-old John Lewis, and the protesters' refusal to back down and give in to the oppressive nature of racism and return violence for violence, they refused to do that. As they did what John Lewis would later call, got into good trouble, necessary trouble. Ultimately, their actions that day would lead to the passing of the Voting Rights Act of 1965. 5 months later, they changed the course of history. In the wake of this shocking incident that was captured on national television on August 6, 1965, 5 months later, 55 years ago next week, then President Lyndon Baines Johnson signed the Voting Rights Act of 1965 into law. Voting, folks. Can't say how crucial it is to vote. We cannot stress it enough. And a lot of times we just tell the next one, you should vote because of what our elders did, what the ancestors did, how they had to go through this. But many of them don't realize exactly what they went through. And a lot of times it only gets to the pain and the suffering that they endured, but not the reasons in their heart as to why they did it. Why John Lewis went on that bridge, why he looked up and saw them waiting, nightsticks in hands like this here, horses ran up, ready to go. Why did they keep on going? Why did they get to the other side, stop and take a knee and pray? Because they knew that unearned suffering was redemptive. They didn't earn that suffering. They didn't deserve what happened. But at the end of that, look what happened. 5 months later, the Voting Rights Act was signed. And a lot of times today, we just don't have it in here why. And we need to impress on people why they did it. Not that they did it, but why they did it. It's key. So now, as I come to a close, talking about, of course, the elder statesman, the Honorable John Lewis, and the connection between his life and voting and how that was a priority for him. And he said that the greatest activism that we can do is to go vote. He wrote an essay prior to his death. Knew he was getting ready to leave here. And he wrote this essay entitled, "Together You Can Redeem the Soul of Our Nation." Together You Can Redeem the Soul of Our Nation. And he asked that this essay would be published in the New York Times on the day of his funeral, which was yesterday, July 30th, 2020. So if you would, please allow me to share the words of the elder statesman, the Honorable John Lewis, okay? And I quote, "While my time here has now come to an end, I want you to know that in the last days and hours of my life, you inspired me." Let me back up and say, there's a large portion of this that was dedicated to our youth movement out here, to the young folks who, just like him at age 23, was on the battlefield fighting for social justice. He wrote, "While my time here has now come to an end, I want you to know that in the last days and hours of my life, you inspired me. You filled me with hope about the next chapter of the great American story when you used your power to make a difference in our society. Millions of people motivated simply by human compassion laid down the burdens of division. Around the country and the world, you set aside race, class, age, language, and nationality to demand respect for human dignity. That is why I had to visit Black Lives Matter Plaza in Washington, though I was admitted to the hospital the following day. I just had to see and feel it for myself that after many years of silent witness, the truth is still marching on. Emmett Till was my George Floyd. He was my Rayshard Brooks and Sandra Bland and Breonna Taylor. He was 14 when he was killed, and I was only 15 years old at the time. I will never, ever forget the moment when it became so clear that he could easily have been me. In those days, fear constrained us like an imaginary prison, and troubling thoughts of potential brutality committed for no understandable reason were the bars. Though I was surrounded by two loving parents, plenty of brothers, sisters, and cousins, their love couldn't protect me from the unholy obsession waiting just outside that family circle. Unchecked, unrestrained violence and government-sanctioned terror had the power to turn a simple stroll to the store for some Skittles or an innocent morning jog down a lonesome country road into a nightmare. If we are to survive as one unified nation, we must discover what so readily takes root in our hearts that could rob Mother Emanuel Church in South Carolina of her brightest and best, shoot unwitting concert goers in Las Vegas, and choke to death the hopes and dreams of a gifted violinist like Elijah McClain. Like so many young people today, I was searching for a way out, or some might say a way in. And then I heard the voice of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. on an old radio. He was talking about the philosophy and discipline of nonviolence. He said, "We are all complicit when we tolerate injustice." He said, "It is not enough to say it will get better by and by." He said, "Each of us has a moral obligation to stand up, and speak out. When you see something that is not right, you must say something. You must do something. Democracy is not a state. It is an act, and each generation must do its part to help build what we call the beloved community, a nation and a world society at peace with itself. Ordinary people with extraordinary vision can redeem the soul of America by getting in what I call good trouble, necessary trouble. Voting and participation in the democratic process are key. The vote is the most powerful nonviolent change agent you have in a democratic society. You must use it because it is not guaranteed. You can lose it. You must also study and learn the lessons of history because humanity has been involved in this soul-wrenching existential struggle for a very long time. People on every continent have stood in your shoes, though decades and centuries before you. The truth does not change. And it is why the answers worked out long ago can help you find solutions to the challenges of our time. Continue to build union between movements stretching across the globe because we must put away our willingness to profit from the exploitation of others. Though I may not be here with you, I urge you to answer the highest calling of your heart and stand up for what you truly believe. In my life, I have done all I can do to demonstrate that way of peace, that the way of peace, the way of love and nonviolence is the more excellent way. Now it is your turn to let freedom ring. When historians pick up their pens to write the story of the 21st century, let them say that it was your generation who laid down the heavy burdens of hate at last, and that peace finally triumphed over violence, aggression, and war. So I say to you, walk with the wind, brothers and sisters. Let the spirit of peace and the power of everlasting love be your guide. John Robert Lewis, before he died, he left those words as a legacy to all. He left those words for our youngsters, and he left those words for you and I. So tonight, as I leave you all with this, that title of the essay that he wrote. Together, we, not you, but we can redeem the soul of our nation. As we think about the powerful image, I don't know if you saw it or not, it's on my Facebook cover. As we think about the powerful image of our NBA players, referees, and officials that they gave us last night, kneeling, taking a knee for the national anthem, we remember, yes, together we can redeem the soul of our nation. LeBron James made a statement that he hopes that him and the NBA players who knelt during the anthem last night made Kaepernick proud, and I'm sure that they did. As people like Taisha Aiken and J.D. Davis in Colleton County joined Erica Coakley and Regina Duggins and Elvin Spates in Charleston County running for seats to stand up for our school children, let us not forget that together we can redeem the soul of our nation. And brothers and sisters, as our young brothers and sisters who are out in the streets continue to get into good trouble, that necessary trouble. We must remember, us old folks must remember, those who they call elders must remember, and we must join them. Why? Because together we can redeem the soul of our nation. We are one. That's how it should be. Frankie Beverly said that. When are we going to get it in our spirits that we are one? And the only way that the one is going to win is if we do it together. We all we got. I don't care who has an issue with anybody else. Find a way to mend that issue. Find a way to get it, get over it. Because we're going to need every soldier on the battlefield of justice that we can get there. We're going to need every voice, every mouth, every vote. every picket sign out here in order to change this miserable condition that we're in. For those who want to say that they follow Malcolm and they woke and all of that, I would encourage you to really wake up and read what Malcolm had to say, especially when he said that he would partner with anybody who was ready to cure this deplorable condition that we live in. Anybody. Malcolm never said that he would not partner with white folks. Mm-mm. Y'all making excuses. Stop it. Stop it. That code word, I see it right now. We're stronger together, and the reality is we are. And as long as we operate as a people like this, if each one of us represents all of the different nationalities, white, black, red, brown, and yellow, as long as we operate like this, we'll never be anything. And then if I could split my fingers up, especially in the inter-ethnicity, and say, okay, this is the black folks, and then we got a whole lot of different splinters off of them. That's not going to work. We're not going to win like that. We have to come together and we have to collectively fight for the greater good, for the good of all. And we need to make sure that as we fight, we're fighting for victory, not for personal gain or for power. For far too long, people have sold us out for personal gain and for power. And it's time to change that. I don't care who it is. I don't care what position you're seeking. And I don't care if you're elected already or not. The people now are going to hold you accountable for the needs of the people, because the time has come for you to slide up under that gate and creep away from your responsibility to serving the people is over. We demand that you represent the people, be it an incumbent or somebody that's running for office. We holding it on you. Forgive me for saying that, but we holding it on you. Okay, together, we can redeem the soul of our nation. For John Lewis, I have no problem saying that. I had a little problem earlier trying to get the words out for the other guy, right? I don't have any words for him. But for somebody like John Lewis, I can proudly and from the heart say, rest in power. Rest in power, black man. Rest in power, brother. Rest in power, warrior. Well done, that good and faithful servant. You served the community and your people all your life from early 20s on. 60 years of service. Well done. Well done. The other guy just sucked up. John Lewis served.